Welcome to the Motor India Show, Raman San.
Thank you, Puno San. Thank you for having me here today.
Yeah, we're going to start with the first question. A person is driving a car. The tires have low pressure, much lower than the prescribed limit. What happens?
Well, if the pressure is low in a tire, usually it will create some issues in terms of noise, vibration. There will be a impact on fuel efficiency. When we are doing our evaluation or when we are doing optimization of the tire along with the vehicle, we do a selection of the pressure in order to keep the optimized NVH for the customer. Anything which is lower than that can impact the performance, and also it will impact the fuel efficiency of the vehicle. So it is important to keep the tire pressure.
My next question is, it's generally known that when you drive for long periods, the tires heat up and the air pressure inside expands. So what happens?
Well, when tires are tested, they are tested for thousands of kilometers and in all climes. So low temperature, high temperature. So absolutely no issue as far as high ambient temperature is concerned. There will be a little increase of temperature, but after some time it stabilizes. So absolutely no problem.
That's wonderful. Suppose a person is driving a car with the air pressure a lot above the prescribed limit. What happens then?
Well, as I said, we are tuning the vehicle for optimized tire pressure. And so anything which we do over, when I explained lower, what happens? But in higher also, there will be an impact. So the ride will become bouncy. The handling will become, different. So I think those kind of issues will come. But of course, one thing is that higher pressure, sometimes the fuel efficiency, the fuel efficiency does improve, but the bouncy ride is there. And when it goes over speed breakers or bumpy roads, it will not give a good comfortable ride to the customer. So I think keeping the tire pressure at the optimum level is very important.
Tires are of the right pressure. You're driving a long stretch and everything is happening fine till you encounter a puncture. What happens then? And you continue driving.
Well, if you are having a puncture on the front tires, you'll immediately sense it because the steering stability will get impacted, and so therefore you will not be able to steer the vehicle properly. So you will immediately realize that and come to a stop because then start making a lot of noise. And if it's on the rear tire, sometimes one doesn't come to know. Or whether there is a puncture, and the customer may not be able to sense it, or if the music is loud, there could be issues on that count. Yeah.
But can this situation get dangerous
on high speeds? If there is a burst of the tire, definitely it could be dangerous. Ability to steer the vehicle becomes a little more difficult if it's on the front tire. On the rear tire, there should not be an issue. It will swerve a bit, but eventually it will come to a halt because of the braking which is happening because one of the tires is punctured. So you'll realize it and suddenly you'll come down.
Okay, we've all gone on a desert safari and we've done dune bashing. And the general practice is that when you do that in an SUV, you lower the tire pressure. Why do you do this? And what happens if you don't do it?
Well, I'll start with if you don't do it, what happens? Because of the optimized tire pressure which is there and the sand being soft, the tire will get, it will dig into the sand. And so therefore the traction will not be there. Because there is no friction. But if you are reducing the tire pressure, you are able to get a better traction because you are able to, the tire will not dig in and it will be a little more flatter. And so therefore it will be able to swerve around in the dunes. So that's a usual thing which people do when they do a desert safari.
Coming to the next question, it is about, you know, putting in a wrong fuel. You got a petrol car, you put in diesel, or you have a diesel car and by mistake you put in petrol. What are the consequences? Yeah. What happens?
Well, usually, we do put a sticker on the fuel lid, inside, saying that it is petrol or diesel, so that the people can understand that. So that just for the filling guy, that he doesn't make a mistake. But having said that, sometimes a mistake does happen, and if you are putting diesel in a petrol vehicle, the diesel is very heavy, and so therefore it will not atomize, and therefore it will lead to higher soot. It will also create misfiring, and it could damage the engine. Whereas if you put up petrol in a diesel vehicle, it will, because of the compression ignition, it will not combustion will not take place because there's no spark plug in there. So therefore it will not run. And also, it will create some issues in terms of lubrication of the parts because diesel is self-lubricating as such. So those kind of issues could be there and could damage the engine.
So there is a good chance of the engine being damaged.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Coming to my next question, you're driving and you realize the coolant is leaked or the engine oil is leaked. What happens?
Well, if the coolant leaks or the engine oil leaks, it's always advisable for the customer to keep looking out for such incidents when you move the vehicle and you are parking in the same spot, when you park it back, you do realize that there is some thing amiss, that okay, there is some leakage which is happening, some droplets of oil or coolant you can see. So therefore you know that there is a problem, and therefore one should definitely get it immediately checked. But having said that, somebody does not check it, then obviously if the coolant is leaked, then most often one will not come to know, and it could lead to engine seizure because the temperature sensor which is there does not, is not able to check the temperature of the coolant because it's checking the temperature of the air and it may be misjudging. And so therefore on the instrument cluster, even though there is a telltale which tells about the engine temperature, but it could be misleading. And so therefore it could lead to engine seizure for sure. The same for oil leakage. If the oil leaks, it doesn't, if there is some small leakage, it doesn't drain off so easily, so instantaneously, unless there is an accident or something. Most cases, one could have this loss of coolant or oil if the car has met with an accident, and therefore the radiator gets hit, and so therefore there's a leakage. That could be one possibility. Or if the oil pan, hits over and goes over a stone or something like that and gets punctured, that could be one possible cause of leakage. Otherwise, there should not be any opportunity for it to leak as such by itself. So it has to be some external impact which could lead to that. And one does know that when that external impact has happened, one should check for it immediately. But otherwise, on its own, it won't leak unless the drain plugs have not been tightened properly or something like that. But that's very, very minimal, such kind of eventuality.
Okay. But in an emergency situation, can we substitute that coolant with water?
Emergency, yes. One time you can, till the next, till you take it to the service center, you can. And then immediately, because the coolant is a pressurized system, so to speak. So water will not work in a coolant system. It can lead to scaling if you are using it for long term. So once you know that in an emergency situation that the coolant has leaked, you can put in water, take it to the next immediate service center and get it fixed. So the hoses may have got cracked or something may have happened, or they could have been accident. So immediately the service center will fix it. That's what one should do. Take it to the nearest service center immediately.
Okay, let's assume these fluids are fine. But what happens if the brake oil leaks? What happens then?
Brake oil should not. Usually brake oil, if there is a leakage, they could. We have two types of circuits in the. So usually, one circuit there is a little leakage, the second circuit will take over, and so it will not come to a emergency situation as such. And again, if it is the brake oil will leak only if there is some impact to. Otherwise, why should it? There should not be any reason for it to impact unless there is an underbody hitting or something which has happened, or the vehicle has met with an accident. There is no reason for the brake oil as such to leak. And one should always watch in the space when they park that if there is any. Something which is liquid is on the floor wherever or on the road wherever they are parking. Usually one should watch for it that such a thing is not there. And if not there, there is no problem. But if there is, then one should take it immediately to the service center to check out whether it's an oil leakage or whether it's some other leakage.
Okay.
Brake oil could also, if there is some issue in terms of the braking system itself, sometimes that could be an issue. But otherwise, it's not usual thing to happen.
Coming to changing a flat tire, not everybody knows how to do that, and not everybody knows how to fix it, fix a jack, and where to fix a jack. Now, if a jack is fixed in the wrong place, what happens?
Usually, in the owner's manual, we do tell the customer, we educate the customer through the owner's manual, where the jacking points are. Every vehicle has got jacking points from where the jack has to be put. And so, therefore, it is important that when one buys a vehicle, that he or she should understand where the jacking points are and then fix the jack at that jacking point. The jack also has some kind of a mechanism to locate the jacking point, and so that the body can get raised properly and the wheel can be taken out properly. So these are precautions which one should take care of when one is doing this. So it's important, otherwise it could lead to some instability if a wrong jacking point is used. Or it may not lift properly. You may not be able to take out the tire. Yeah.
You're driving your car and for some very strange reason, the driver just tries to yank out the key. What happens?
I wonder why should one do that. One should not stop the vehicle when it's running. When you are cruising, one should not try to stop the vehicle or turn the engine off, because after some time you'll feel a loss of vacuum also from the engine. It could be an issue in terms of braking. So there's no need for anybody to be doing that, what I believe.
Okay, but in case someone insists on doing it, for some very strange reason, does the car stop?
Unless there is an emergency or something like that, one is trying to stop the vehicle, then only one is trying to switch off the engine, it's a very unusual circumstance is what I think.
Let me just add to that, sir. Does it in any way damage any of the parts when you do such a strange thing?
Well, why should anybody do that when one is running? If one has to stop the vehicle, one should apply the brake, come to the side and then turn the vehicle off, is the advice I would like to give.
Okay. So, similarly, in a push button where the start stop button is there. Well, you do the same thing. You insist on pressing the stop while the car is running. What happens?
Well, if in an emergency situation, one would like to explain that if you are, you know, you need to press it for a continuous period for it to stop. Maybe a couple of seconds. If you have to continuously, if you want to stop, then you should push the push start button for a couple of seconds, and then only it will stop. Or you have to do it, you know, three times, you know, intermittently, so that it can stop. So those are the two things, you know, one should know that how to stop when, you know, in an emergency situation, one wants to stop the engine. But otherwise, there's no reason for anybody to, while running, to stop the engine.
And like I said, these are very strange scenarios. You're driving and suddenly someone yanks the handbrake, engages it. What happens?
Well, what happens is that the front wheel is, you know, at the normal speed at which the customer is driving, and the rear wheel gets, you know, kind of the brake happens on the rear wheel, and that could lead to some spin in the vehicle, which is very dangerous, and one should not be attempted.
What happens when the handbrake is not fully disengaged and you continue driving?
Well, if the handbrake is not fully engaged, it's not fully disengaged, then you know, you'll feel a sluggishness on the vehicle, feel very sluggish. You will kind of also, it will impact your fuel efficiency, it will impact your the brake friction material, that will get eroded. And you also have a telltale on the instrument cluster, which actually tells you that if the handbrake is on. So one should watch out for these telltales also. One should understand these telltales are for giving information to the customer that there is likely to be something wrong, whether it is low oil pressure or whether it is temperature is not okay, engine temperature is not okay, or the parking brake is on. So these are things which one should be looking out for. And also you have engine malfunction indicator is there. So that means that there's something wrong. And so therefore the customer should actually take the vehicle to the service center. That's why we call it telltale, so that it tells the customer that, okay, there's something, an issue, please go to the service center.
The strange way of driving continues, and you're driving and suddenly this driver tries to slot into the reverse gear. What happens then?
It not go because there is a mechanical inhibitor system in the reverse gear. And if one does try to do forcefully from the fourth gear, there'll be a loud clashing noise, and so therefore one would know that there is something wrong. And usually in some of the six-speed gearboxes, you will find a knob which is there, which has to be pulled up in order to engage into the reverse gear. And that is available in some models, in some OEMs, in the five-speed also. So I think that is an additional system which people do use. For sure, it will not slot because it will be a lot of clashing noise if you try to do that. Sometimes, you know, you do that, and absent-mindedly you do it, and you hear this clashing sound, you know that there's something wrong, and then you go back to the fourth gear, or you go back to the fifth gear.
This is the same thing with an automatic car?
An automatic transmission, you know, one can't shift the gear position because if you are in drive mode, you will have to come down to a lower, much lower speed, less than 10 kilometers to almost a standstill for you to, you know, slot the gear shift into the reverse. So in automatic, it is, that's how it happens.
Okay.
One can't push it so easily.
Coming to a manual car, a car with a manual transmission, you're driving, but you've got the clutch half depressed, while some people have that crazy habit. So what happens then?
Well, you know, this is something which we always we used to see it in the past. Most customers have learned that they should not be riding the clutch, and sometimes people do ride the clutch, and then it you are actually impacting the acceleration and the drivability of the vehicle if you are doing that. Also, it's impacting the clutch wear, and so therefore you will get a lesser clutch life. So it's not at all advisable. The clutch should only be used, it should be depressed only for change of gear. Once that is done, the job is done. So one should not be putting the foot on the clutch at all.
Okay.
One should learn this, and that's the way to drive.
Perfect. Now it's a very warm day, and you're enjoying your drive, but you're also feeling a little sleepy. So you park your car under a tree, perhaps in the open, and switch on the air conditioner, and the engine is running, and you want to take a nap for more than an hour or almost an hour. What happens?
Well, nothing. If it's in the open, it should not be too much of an issue, but you'll lose a lot of lose a lot of fuel, and so when you're doing tank to tank calculation, the fuel efficiency will show up to be very, very less. So that's one impact. If your driver is doing that, usually that's what happens, and so the fuel efficiency comes down. Apart from that, I think it is always advisable to because if it's in recirculation, there is a contamination of the air. So and you are sleeping, so it's better that you if you are doing that, open the windows a little bit, fresh air comes in. So that's one way to do that. And if the family is there and you are wanting to have a break for 10-15 minutes, you want to keep the AC on, just roll down a little bit of the windows so that fresh air does come in.
Does this situation worsen if you take the car into a garage, everything is closed, and yet you want to snuggle inside the car with the air conditioner on and the engine running?
I don't know why one would want to do that, but having done that, not at all advisable, because in a closed space, you are the exhaust can get mixed into the fresh air. And because that recirculation is happening within a particular area, so therefore one should avoid doing that.
Coming to a few more safety related questions, you are driving your car, and these cars are equipped with airbags, but you're not wearing your seat belts. You meet with an accident, unfortunately, the airbags get deployed. What happens?
Very dangerous thing to do, especially with front airbag being there, because the injury will impact. And these are supplementary restraint system. The primary restraint system is the seatbelt. So therefore, people should use the seatbelt. 55-60% of the injury gets reduced if you are wearing seatbelts. And we as manufacturers provide seatbelts in all the seats. If it's a five-seater, it's all five seats have a seatbelt. Everybody should wear a seatbelt, not just in front, but also in the rear. And that saves lives. And if one is not wearing a seatbelt in the front, then the airbag is deployed. Obviously, the injury criteria could be very high, and could be even fatal sometimes. So not just because of the crash, but it's also because of the airbag going in the face. So it's a double thing.
I've seen a lot of people driving around with very large size tires. They look very handsome and smart. And what happens when you do a thing like this, when the tires are much bigger than what is the recommended size?
It's not recommended. As OEMs, we will never recommend that people should use oversized tires, because if in order to fit, then they will have to make some changes mechanically in the linkage system. They have to put an offset in the hub so that the tire can fit, and that's not at all recommended in terms of the from a vehicle performance point of view also. So, and also if you know, if you see the kinematics of the vehicle and such that, you know, when you are the steering is also you know, kind of governing that kind of tire size which you have got, and the tire wheel houses are also there. So all of this is engineered like that. If you put a bigger tire size into such in a normal vehicle wheel house, it will not take it. It will clash somewhere. It will, you know. So those are things, and that's why the tires are put out. Okay, put a bigger tire. So it's not at all recommended.
When you put these tires, do these tires actually clear the wheel alignment and wheel balancing norms?
I don't think they would because the kinematics may not allow for that. Alignment as such, you know, they are there, though, but not fully aligned to the steering system. Recommended at all. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Raman-san, for joining us.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Punasan. Thank you so much. Pleasure. Yeah.